हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज़ अ सिंपल चैप्टर न्यूक्लियाई और न्यूक्लियर फिजिक्स. लेट अस गो थ्रू फ्यू बेसिक्स एंड दिस बेसिक्स यू हैव ऑलरेडी लर्नड इन केमिस्ट्री एंड इन योर हाई स्कूल स्टडीज. टोटल नंबर ऑफ प्रोटॉन्स एंड न्यूट्रॉन्स इन ए न्यूक्लियस इज कॉल्ड मास नंबर डिनोटेड बाय ए. टोटल नंबर ऑफ प्रोटॉन्स इन ए न्यूक्लियस इज कॉल्ड atomic number denoted by Z. Suppose if it is carbon 14, C for carbon, 6, 14, then this is atomic number Z, means number of protons is 6. This is mass number denoted by A. So A is 14. Therefore, number of neutrons is A minus Z. This is number of protons. Number of protons and number of neutrons. Therefore, A minus Z is number of neutrons. So, it is 8. So, in carbon 6, 14, number of neutrons is 8. Therefore, total number of neutrons in a nucleus is A minus Z. In general, a nucleus is represented by carbon 6, 12, oxygen 8, 16. You can also see notations like oxygen 8, 16. Okay. Doesn't matter with respect to position, but usually atomic number will be at the bottom. Example, uranium 238. 92 238. So atomic number is 92, mass number is 238, therefore A minus Z is bandechine A minus Z is 146. This is number of neutrons. Isotopes are nuclei having same atomic number but different mass numbers. As an example, 1H1, atomic number is 1, 1H2, again atomic number is 1, but mass numbers are different. So these two are called isotopes. 8O16, oxygen 8-16, oxygen 8-17, so these two are isotopes. So we can find a number of isotopes for many elements. And the number of isotopes for a given element is limited in nature. Nuclei having same mass number but different atomic numbers. 1H3, 2He3. See, mass numbers are same, atomic numbers are different. Then these two are called isobars. Nuclei having equal number of neutrons but different atomic numbers are called isotones. Equal number of neutrons, isotones. 1H3, so 3 minus 1. 3 minus 1 is 2. 2He4, 4 minus 2. 4 minus 2 is 2. So this has 2 neutrons. This also has 2 neutrons. Therefore, these two are isotones. Isotopes, isobars, isotones. Nuclear mass is about 99.9% of the atomic mass. Atom means there is a nucleus positively charged and there are revolving electrons. The share of nuclear mass is maximum compared to the share of mass of electrons. Therefore, atomic mass is almost equal to the nuclear mass. Nuclear radius is about 10 power minus 5 times the radius of the radius of atoms. Because radius of atoms is of the order of minus 10 meter. And radius of nucleus is of the order of minus 15 meter. We will see how it is 10 power minus 15 meter. Okay. Hydrogen, deuterium, tritium are isotopes of hydrogen. Their masses are in the ratio 1:2:3. So if it is hydrogen, 1H1, deuterium 1H2, tritium 1H3. Their masses are in the ratio 1:2:3. Now, an important topic. This can be asked for 1 mark, 2 mark or 3 marks. General characteristics of nucleus. So in that, first one, nuclear size. Generally, nuclei are found to have spherical shape. If R is radius of the nucleus and mass number is A, then. So early experiments revealed that nucleus is spherical in shape. Okay. And if it is spherical, there should be a radius. And radius is given by R naught A to the power of 1/3. Where this is mass number, this is nuclear radius parameter. It's about 1.2 femtometer. So R naught is 1.2 femtometer. Femto is 10 to the power of minus 15 meter. Okay. And A is mass number. So this is for 1 mark. Nuclear charge. Nucleus has protons and neutrons. But neutrons are neutrally charged, protons are positively charged. If there are Z number of protons and charge of each proton is plus E, then total charge is plus Z into E. This is charge of the nucleus. So nuclear charge is charge of the nucleus, which is total charge of protons. Nuclear mass. Total mass of nucleons is also taken as nuclear mass. Total mass of nucleons means Z number of protons, mass of each proton plus A number, A minus Z number of neutrons into mass of each neutron. That gives total mass of the nucleus, M. This is also called total mass of nucleons. Nucleons means protons and neutrons together called nucleons. Next, nuclear density. Nuclear density is density of the nucleus. So nuclear density is about 2.3 10 to the power of 17 kg per meter cube, which is very high. So which is the densest object in the universe means it is the nucleus. So nuclear density equal to mass of nucleus by volume of nucleus. So total mass of nucleons is Z times mass of proton plus A minus Z times mass of neutron. This gives total mass of nucleons divided by volume of the nucleus. If it is assumed to be spherical, 4/3 pi r cube. But mass of proton is approximately equal to mass of neutron. Mass of proton is approximately equal to mass of neutron, and r equal to r naught A to the power of 1/3, capital R or small r. This denotes radius of the nucleus. Okay. If proton mass is approximately, not if, since proton mass is approximately equal to neutron mass and R is this, let us substitute these two in this equation. We get density equal to Z times mass of proton plus A minus Z times mass of proton, 4/3 pi r cube is r naught a power 1/3 cube. a to the power of 1 by 3 cube get cancels. So denominator we have 4 by 3 pi r naught cube into a. Numerator z times mass of proton minus z times mass of proton. Therefore this get cancels with this. So numerator is a times mass of proton. A times mass of proton. Observe, a get cancels. Therefore density of the nucleus is mass of proton by 4 by 3 pi r naught cube. Mass of proton is a constant, r naught is a constant, these are constants. Therefore when we simplify all this we get 2.3 10 to the power of 17 kg per meter cube. That you can find here. R is equal to R naught A to the power of 1 by 3. Substitute, simplify, you'll get all constants, which is independent of A. Students, observe, there is no A term. Means nuclear density is independent of A. For all the nuclei, density is same. Nuclear mass is determined by an instrument called mass spectrometer. This is for 1 mark. Mass spectrometer actually measures the atomic mass of the given element. Since electron is 1836 times less massive than proton, protons are very massive compared to electrons, okay, its mass is neglected. So this spectrometer measures mass of atoms, which is taken as mass of the nucleus, because electron mass is negligibly small compared to mass of protons, okay. One more important topic, nuclear forces. This can be asked for 1 mark, 2 mark, 3 or 5 marks, okay. Characteristics of nuclear force. Students, through these characteristics, try to visualize nuclear force, okay. How it could be, what is the nature. So you can visualize based on this. These are the strongest among the known forces. In 11th standard, we studied that there are 4 basic forces. Gravitation, gravitational force, electromagnetic force, strong nuclear force, and weak nuclear force. Nuclear force, okay. Among these, this is the strongest force. So we are talking about strong nuclear force, okay. So in general, nuclear force refers to strong nuclear force, not weak nuclear force. They are short range forces. Short range means nuclear force is observed only inside the nucleus. If this is a proton and this is a proton, there exists attraction between these two. If there is another proton outside the nucleus, then these protons fail to exert force on this proton, because this third proton is out of the nuclear range. Means in a small region nuclear force is felt. That is the meaning, they are short range. Strongest short range. Third is charge independent. If there is a nucleus with protons and neutrons, there exists attraction between proton and neutron. There exists attraction between proton and neutron. Neutrons are neutrally charged. Still there exists attraction between neutrons. That is the meaning, nuclear force is charge independent. Nuclear force is spin dependent. Okay. So let this be under the characteristics of nucleus. Let me not explain this spin dependent. In chemistry, you have read about spin of nucleus, spin of atoms. Okay. So based on that concept, spin dependent. they are non-central forces. Central forces means the one which follows 1 by r square, inverse square law. But nuclear force doesn't follow inverse square law, that is why it is called a non-central force. They exhibit saturation property. Sixth, saturation property means chain like. Okay, if this is a nucleus, this proton exerts force on this proton, this proton exerts force on this neutron, this neutron exerts force on this proton. In turn, this proton is like exerting force on this proton. This is not directly exerting force on this proton, but this exerts force on this, this exerts force on this, this exerts force on this. That is why this can exert force on the last proton. So this property is called saturation property. Seventh, they are non-conservative forces. Conservative forces means work done equal to force dot displacement. If work done depends on displacement and not on the path, then such a force is called a conservative force. But here it is a non-conservative force, means it depends on the path. Conservative, it is independent of the path, whereas non-conservative depends on the path, means we cannot use work equal to force dot displacement for this nuclear force. Now there is a graph mentioned in the NCERT textbook. Potential energy on y-axis, distance on x-axis. Distance is in femtometer, potential energy is in mega electron volt, MeV. Mega is 10^6 electron volt, unit of energy, isn't it? Now with the decrease in distance, if this is the nucleus, from the center up to this point it is r naught. After that, as the distance decreases, as the point approaches the nucleus, potential energy decreases. Actually observe, if the point is far away from the nucleus, then there is no nuclear force, very small. So that is why the curve is negative, means attractive potential, and very small, almost constant. If distance is far away from the nucleus, point is far away from the nucleus, then attractive potential, but very small. And as the point approaches the nucleus, the attraction increases. And inside the nucleus, within r naught, it is very attractive force. And if points are very close to each other, if this is the nucleus, if points are very close to each other, then one proton cannot be squeezed into the other proton. So at very small distances, it becomes repulsive. It becomes repulsive is represented by this positive potential. Positive potential means repulsion. Negative potential means attraction. Now, this is for 1 or 2 mark. Marks. Einstein's mass energy equivalence relation. So this is one of the most famous relation, isn't it? E equal to mc square, where m is mass, c is speed of light in vacuum. If there is 1 gram of mass, if this 1 gram of mass is completely converted into energy, then the energy released is mc square, equal to mass is 1 gram, 1 gram is 10^-3 kg into 3 × 10^8 square, equal to 3^2 = 9, 10^8² = 16, 16 - 3 is 10^13. joule. This is how we can use energy calculation. Okay, this is not energy released due to combustion. This is not energy released due to chemical reaction. This is the energy equivalent of mass. When this mass is completely converted into energy, then the amount of energy released is this. So what is the validity of this E equal to mc square means? In three places it is verified. First is pair production. When a high energy photon traverses close to a massive nucleus, gets converted into pair of particles, an electron and a positron. Electron and a positron. If this is radiation, then in laboratory they observed an electron and a positron. This is schematic representation. Okay, radiation to masses. Electron has mass, positron also has equal mass, but their charges are opposite. This is positron, this is electron. So radiation to mass, energy to mass, energy to mass according to mc square. Annihilation of matter. Opposite of pair production is annihilation. If electron comes in contact with a positron, then these two will vanish and there is emission of a photon. So this is schematic representation. Mass to radiation, mass to energy, energy to mass, masses. Nuclear reactions. Fission reaction, fusion reaction, there how energy is calculated means it is using E equal to mc square. Atomic mass unit, AMU, or simply U. Okay, sometimes they use AMU or simply U. What is atomic mass unit means? It is 1/12 of the mass of an atom of carbon 12 isotope. 1/12 of mass of an atom of carbon 12 isotope. So this is one atomic mass unit. From Avogadro concept, 12 kg of carbon 12 has 6.023 × 10⁶ atoms. Students, observe, if it is 12 kg, then 10⁶ atoms. If it is 12 gram, it is 10⁷. Okay, give attention to these two. Since it is 12 kg, it is 10⁶ atoms. So mass of one atom is 12 by this kg. By definition, one atomic mass unit is 1/12 of this mass. So 1/12 of 12 by Avogadro number, which is approximately 1.66 × 10⁻²⁷ kg. Okay, this is the relation between atomic mass unit and kg. Students, copy this and practice. This can be asked for 3 marks. Now, relation between one atomic mass unit and electron volt. Actually, continuation of this. According to mass, Einstein's mass energy relation, E is mc square. In place of m, let us substitute 1 amu. C is 3×10⁸ whole square. And one atomic mass unit is 1.66 × 10⁻²⁷ c square. I want in electron volt, therefore let me divide this by charge of electron. Upon simplification, we get value close to this, and this is the accepted value. Okay, you may not get this 931 using this, but very close to 931. Okay, but this is the internationally accepted value. So one atomic mass unit equal to 1.66 × 10⁻²⁷ kg. Atomic mass unit in terms of kg, and atomic mass unit in terms of energy means it is 931 MeV, mega electron volt. So this can be asked for 3 or 5 marks. Okay, so these are masses in terms of atomic mass unit. Students, you don't have to remember all these values, just for observation. Mass of proton 1.00 something atomic mass unit means 1.007276 times 1.66 × 10⁻²⁷ kg. This is how we should convert for calculations in terms of SI. Okay, mass of neutron slightly greater than mass of proton, mass of electron very small compared to mass of proton and neutron. Now, electron volt, it is unit of energy, isn't it? It is not SI unit, it is unit of energy. One electron volt is the energy gained by an electron when accelerated through a potential difference of 1 volt. This is one plate. This is second plate. This is at 30 volt. This is at 29 volt. If there is an electron, everything goes from a region of higher potential to lower potential. But electron moves from a region of lower potential to higher potential. Okay, since it is negatively charged. We are keeping, but this electron is accelerated, means this electron gains energy. Energy gained by electron under a potential difference of 1 volt. See, 30 volt, 29 volt, difference is 1 volt. This is electron. So energy is 1 EV. Suppose this is 30 volt and this is 25 volt. We'll gain energy 5 EV. 30 difference 25. Is 5 EV. Next, mass defect. Defect in mass is mass defect. And what is actually mass defect means? Total mass of nucleons minus mass of the nucleus as measured from spectrometer. This difference is mass defect. Observe. There are 4 identical spheres. Okay, what is the total mass? If mass of each sphere is 1 kg, again there are 4 identical spheres, mass of each is 1 kg, therefore total mass is 4 kg, isn't it? But if these 4 masses are together very close to each other, then total mass turns out to be say 3.9 kg. See, they are away from each other 4 kg, they are very close to each other 3.9 kg. There is some defect in mass, isn't it? That defect is 4 minus 3.9 equal to 0.1 kg. So this 0.1 kg is the mass defect when the nucleons are together. This we won't observe in macroscopic world, but in microscopic world this is true. So 4 kg is like total mass of nucleons, 3.9 kg is mass of the nucleus, difference of these two is mass defect. Next, binding energy. Binding energy is energy equivalent of mass defect. So energy, binding energy is delta m, delta m is mass defect into c square. Okay, mass into c square is energy, mass defect into c square is binding energy. Binding energy is the energy with which nucleons are held together. If this is the nucleus, these are the nucleons, they are held together with nuclear force. With what energy they are held together means it is the binding energy. And how to find binding energy means it is the energy equivalent of mass defect. If mass defect delta m is in kg, then to find binding energy, delta m into c square, this will be in terms of joule, divide this by charge of an electron, 1.6 10 power minus 19. This whole thing will be in EV. That is true only when mass defect is in kg. Okay. Suppose mass defect is in atomic mass unit, delta m is in amu, then mass defect into 931 MeV. Directly you multiply 931. If this is in atomic mass unit, multiplied by 931. If delta m is in kg, then c square by charge of electron, and these two gives the same answer. Okay. Nucleons are bound to the nucleus with energies of the order of MeV. MeV, mega electron volt, 10 to the power of 6 electron volt. The electrons are bound to the atom with energies of the order of EV. Atoms, EV. Nucleus, MeV. That is why in hydrogen atom, we had this equation. En equal to minus 13.6 EV by n square. See, just EV. Whereas nucleons are bound with energy 10 to the power of 6 EV. Now, nuclear fission. Observe. If this is a nucleus, these values are exaggerated values. Just to understand, it is fine. Okay. Let mass of this be 10 kg. If this mass is split into two, this is 4 kg and the other is 5.9 kg. Observe, total mass was 10 kg. When we split, its total mass is 5.9 plus 4 is 9.9 kg. So there is some defect in mass. That mass defect is 0.1 kg. And this 0.1 kg is converted into energy according to E equal to mc square. This is the source of energy during fission reaction. So instead of this huge mass, imagine a nucleus whose total mass is 10 unit. If it is split, remaining masses will be less. There is defect in mass. Energy equivalent of that defect in mass is the energy released during fission process. So nuclear fission is a process in which heavy nucleus splits into lighter nuclei of comparable masses. This is important, comparable masses, releasing 2 or 3 neutrons and a large amount of energy. Okay. So as an example, uranium-235, 92, is bombarded with a neutron. Neutron is 0,1 or 0,1. Okay. Then this neutron momentarily stays inside the nucleus. Therefore, it becomes uranium-236, 92. 92 plus 0 is 92. 235 plus 1 is 236. After that, this splits into, say, barium and krypton. Barium is 56, 144. Krypton is 36, 89. Plus, in this probability of fission, 3 neutrons are emitted. 3 neutrons, again 0,1. You can write 0,1 on one side or 0,1 like this. Okay. Uranium-235 can also split in different ways. This is second way. neutron hits a uranium nucleus, 235, it becomes 236 momentarily. After that, it splits into two nuclei of comparable masses. See, 51 atomic number, 41, with four neutrons. Another probability, neutron hitting a uranium nucleus, XE 54 and SR 38, with only one neutron. Students, please remember any one of these equations. Okay, this can be asked for 1 mark. Statement is for 1 mark. Example reaction is for 1 mark. Okay, not all the three, just one is enough. So what is the source of energy in fission reaction means? Missing mass is the source of energy. Chain reaction. A chain reaction is a self-sustained process in which number of neutrons and hence the number of fission multiplies rapidly with respect to time during fission. So in high school also you have read about chain reaction. If this is a nucleus bombarded by a neutron, then this splits into comparable masses with the release of, say, 3 neutrons. These 3 neutrons may take part in next stage reaction, chain reaction, fission reaction. This neutron may split this nucleus. This neutron may split this nucleus. This neutron may split this nucleus. See, from one fission, 3 neutrons. Suppose a similar kind happens, then in this fission also 3 more neutrons are produced. Here also 3 more neutrons. Here also 3 more neutrons. Not necessarily 3, 3, any number. But in our example, let us use 3. These 3 will again take part in 3 fission reactions. 3 fission reactions. 3 fission reactions. Now, from each fission, again 3, 3 neutrons means, see, from 1 neutron to 3, 3 neutron to 9, 9 to, so the number of neutrons multiplies. Number of fission reactions also increases rapidly. It is like chain. So that is why this is called a chain reaction. Controlled chain reaction, uncontrolled chain reaction. If we can control the number of reactions, then we can harness that energy. We can use that energy. If it is uncontrolled, blast all of a sudden means that can be used for destructive purpose. So this is the principle of atom bomb and this is the principle of nuclear reactor. Because fission reaction in a reactor should be controlled. Let us go through. In this type, the neutron population is allowed to reach a desired steady level and thereafter the number of fission producing reaction neutrons is maintained constant. So first the number of neutrons should increase. After that, the number of neutrons is maintained constant. At every stage, if the number of neutrons is constant, then equal number of fission reactions take place. As a result, constant energy output is observed. Uncontrolled, in this type, the number of neutrons is allowed to multiply indefinitely, leading to violent explosion. This is the principle behind atom bomb. 1 neutron, 1 neutron to 3 neutron, 3 to 9 neutron, 9 to 27 neutron, and every stage the number of neutrons increases means energy also increases. All of a sudden, large amount of energy is released, means we can't control. We can't control means it is a bomb. Next, nuclear reactor. A nuclear reactor is an arrangement in which sustained chain reaction, controlled chain reaction can be realized and a controlled supply of energy can be obtained. So it's a device, it is an arrangement, it's a complex arrangement. This is for 1, 2 or 3 marks. Types of reactors. Power reactor, breeder reactor, research reactor. Name itself says, This reactor is used to generate power, electricity, nuclear energy. It is used for the production of electrical energy from nuclear energy. Research reactor, it is for research purpose. It is used for producing isotopes, gamma rays and neutrons required for research. Breeder reactor. This uranium-238 cannot be used as such. So it should be suitably converted to some other form where we can directly use. So this uranium-238 is converted into PU-239. This can be used. This can be used in warheads, or this can be used for any other research purpose. So conversion of one isotope into an isotope of another element is done in this breeder reactor. So types of reactors are enough: power reactor, breeder reactor, research reactor. Now, power reactor. The basic principle of power reactor is to carry out sustained chain reaction at a constant rate. It should be operated in critical condition. Critical condition means K should be equal to 1. Let us go through this K later. Time being, in power reactor, K should be equal to 1. When a reactor is under control, reaction is under control, energy output is under control, then we say that the reactor is critical. Critical doesn't mean that it is out of control. Critical means it is under control. Okay. Nuclear fuel. Uranium-235, uranium-233, PU-239 are used. These are called fissile materials. Fuel is usually placed inside metallic tubes, and these tubes are called fuel elements. So in a nuclear reactor, in metal tubes, these fissile materials are filled. So these are called the fuel for the nuclear reactor. Observe, U-235 is there, U-233 is there, not 38. 238 cannot be directly used in the nuclear reactor. That is where the breeder reactor is used. Okay. Reproduction factor or multiplication factor, denoted by K. It is rate of production of neutrons by rate of loss of neutrons. K is rate of production. Rate of loss of neutrons at any stage. If K equal to 1, production equal to loss. If this equal to this, then K equal to 1, isn't it? At any stage, suppose nuclear reaction started here with a neutron, then after number of stages, here 10 to the power of 10 neutrons are there. In next stage also, 10 to the power of 10 neutrons are there. Next stage also, 10 to the power of 10 neutrons are there, means the rate of production should be equal to rate of loss. Then K is said to be 1. And this is the principle of nuclear reactor. So reactor is said to be critical. It is said to be under control. And this is the principle of nuclear reactor. Students, question could be like this. For what value of K, reactor is said to be critical? It is K equal to 1. Okay. Now, if K greater than 1, K greater than 1 means K is rate of production by rate of loss of neutrons. K greater than 1 means production should be more. At every stage, production should increase, means we get more and more energy out of it every second. As a result, it goes out of control. This is said to be supercritical. Supercritical means out of control. And the chain reaction is said to be uncontrolled. And this is the principle behind atom bomb. Bomb means for destructive purpose, isn't it? Put the bomb, forget it. There, large amount of energy should be released from time to time. Uncontrolled. K less than 1. K less than 1 means production should be less. Production is less, loss is more. Every stage, loss is more means after some time, the reaction should stop. So this is said to be subcritical. K less than 1 is for subcritical. The chain reaction gradually decreases and comes to an end. So statement of reproduction factor or multiplication factor with three different cases. Now, different parts of a nuclear reactor. Moderator. It is a material used to slow down fast neutrons which are produced during nuclear reaction. This is the place where fission reaction takes place. After fission reaction, there is emission of large number of neutrons at very high speeds. So these are called fast neutrons. Fast neutrons are not required for fission reaction. They should be slowed down. That is why moderator is used. If this is moderator, when fast neutrons pass through the moderator, then speed of neutron decreases. So job of the moderator is to decrease the speed of neutrons. Example, graphite, heavy water. H2O is water, D2O is heavy water. Beryllium. Next, coolant. So inside the nuclear reactor, heat is generated, it should be extracted. So for extraction of heat, some medium should be used. So that is coolant. It is a fluid used to remove or extract heat energy generated in the core in the form of heat. D2O, heavy water, water, liquid sodium, etc. These are the coolant. Reflector, which is used to reflect neutrons. It is used to minimize loss of neutrons from the core of the reactor. If this is the core of the reactor, if neutrons are emitted, there should not be loss of neutrons. Neutrons should be reflected back. Neutrons should be reflected back. So a lining of reflector is given to the reactor core. Usually graphite. Reactor shield. If this is the reactor, neutrons should not escape at the same time. Gamma rays should not escape. So shield should be provided. It is a thick concrete wall which acts as pressure container for the core of the reactor. Thickness is about 3 meter. The shield also prevents harmful radiation and energetic particles from the core entering into the atmosphere. So this is the reactor shield. Control rods. Every stage, number of neutrons increases. But we want number of neutrons constant. Say 10 to the power of 10, next stage 10 to the power of 12, next stage 10 to the power of 13, next stage 10 to the power of 15. So number of neutrons increases means it behaves like bomb. So to control the number of neutrons, control rods are used. So control rods will absorb some amount of neutrons. As a result, we can get constant number of neutrons. Thereby everything is under control. Students, this is for controlled chain reaction. This is for uncontrolled chain reaction. Cadmium, boron are used as control rods. Heat exchanger. Heat exchanger is a huge chamber in which ordinary water is pumped in and absorbs heat from the coolant and converts water into superheated steam. So from the coolant, energy is extracted in the heat exchanger. Go through the diagram of a nuclear reactor and find the position of heat exchanger. Okay. Nuclear reactor is also called atomic pile. Natural uranium contains 0.7 of uranium, 0.7% of U-235 and more than 99% of U-238. Only this is used in reactor, not this. U-235 can undergo fission both by fast and slow neutrons, but the probability is more for slow neutrons. Okay, so to decrease the speed of fast neutrons, moderators are used. So as a result, they become slow neutrons. The process in which percentage of U-235 is increased is called enrichment. This is a sample with U-235 and U-238. So by removing U-238 in this sample, U-235 can be increased, means enrichment is happening. The process which increases the percentage of U-235 is called enrichment. Nuclear fusion reaction. It is a phenomena in which two light nuclei fuse to form heavy nucleus with the release of energy. Now observe, this is a mass of 2 kg. This is another mass, 3 kg. When they are put together, total mass is 4.9 kg. See, separately it is 5 kg. But when they are together, it is 4.9 kg. So you can clearly see the mass defect, missing mass. So the missing mass is 5 kg minus 4.9 kg is 0.1 kg. When two lighter nuclei combine to form a heavy nucleus, then small mass will be missing, and this missing mass is the source of energy. Okay. Now, different fusion probabilities. 1H1 plus 1H1, 1 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 1 is 2, there is one more 1 remaining, radiation with the release of energy, 0.42 MeV. Now, this 1H2 plus 1H2, 2He3, there is a neutron here, neutron is 0, 1, observe, 2 plus 2 is 4, 3 plus 1 is 4, 1 plus 1 is 2, 2 plus 0 is 2. Similarly, this is 1, 0. This is also a beta particle. Beta plus. Now, 1H2 plus 1H2 leading to 1H3. 1 plus 1 is 1. The other one is here. 2 plus 2 is 4. There is 3. The remaining one is here. See, two lighter nuclei is fused to become a heavy nucleus with some other. 2 lighter to 1 heavy with neutron. 2 lighter to heavy with 1 hydrogen. So these are different types of fusion reactions. Students, please remember any one reaction for 1 mark. Okay. What is fusion reaction means? 2 lighter nuclei fused to form a heavy nucleus with the release of energy. The source of energy in sun is nuclear fusion reaction. There are set of equations in the textbook. Just go through those equations, and these are not required for examination. Okay. So this is how fusion reaction can be achieved. Continuation of the reactions. See, every stage, some amount of energy is released, and that energy will be in terms of MeV. Radiation in terms of MeV means very high energy. So these are the resultant equations. 4 atoms of 1H1 gives 1 atom of 2He3. Or 4 nuclei of 1H gives 1 nucleus of 2He4. Instead of atoms, nucleus is better term. Okay. With the release of energy gamma as well as energy. Now this is important from the examination point of view. Differences between fission reaction and fusion reaction. Fission, radius statement for fission, radius statement for fusion, that itself is a difference. Fission, it is the splitting up of a heavy nucleus into lighter nuclei of comparable masses. It is the fusion of lighter nuclei into heavier nucleus. Done. Energy released per fission is greater. In a fission reaction, say about 200 MeV of energy is released. About 200 MeV. Energy released per fusion is about 25 MeV. You don't have to mention the numbers. Just say energy per fission is greater. Energy per fusion is less. Energy released per unit mass, say 1 kg of fission, energy released is less. In 1 kg of fusion, energy released will be more. This is 1 fission, 1 fusion. This is 1 kg fission, 1 kg fusion. This energy is less, sorry, greater per fission. Energy is less per unit mass in the case of fission. Okay. The products are radioactive. Here they are non-radioactive. Non-radioactive. Fifth important interesting concept. Ordinary temperature is sufficient to start fission reaction. Fission reaction at any temperature. But for fusion reaction, very high temperature is required. So that is why fusion reaction is also called thermonuclear reactions. Thermonuclear reaction means very high temperature is required to start fusion reaction. That's a technical challenge. Students, copy these. These are required for final exam. Okay. Differences between fission and fusion.